testimonies of praise reports, of prayers that have been answered. We know that God is still able. And so if you would just put that in the comments, we'll make sure to include you in our prayer group as well. Thank you for joining us this morning online.
And if you're worshiping with us in the family room here in person this morning, we also invite you to put your prayer request on that back part of the Connect card. And if this is your first time with us, we are so glad you're here. Yes. You are in for a treat this morning. Oh, yeah. God is moving and there's so many wonderful things happening. We have a special music group this morning as well. But please go ahead and fill out that Connect card that's in the seat back in front of you, or just scan the QR code with your smartphone and fill that out. And we would love to connect with you and just tell you more about our ministry and the ways that we reach out to our community. And we want to connect with you as well.
Absolutely. And today's a special day for our guests.
That's right. That's right. So if you are interested in learning more about the Westmore family, our ministry, the vision behind what we do, and meet the pastor and some of the other staff, we have a special luncheon once a month. And actually, we have one today after the service.
It's your lucky day.
That's right. So if you're new and you don't have lunch plans and want to hear more about Westmore, come on and join us. And if you're interested in membership, this is a great way to begin your process, which is joining this luncheon.
Yep. So we'd love to have you join us for that. And there is a lot going on here with the vision of the church, as well as just the activities of the church. And one of the great areas is our Next Gen ministry. So our Next Gen ministry is from children all the way through college, young adult. And beginning this fall, we have the Early Learning Academy, and that's still in process of getting everything ready for that. So if you're interested in an early learning academy for your children or grandchildren, Anna Anderson is the director, and that would be aanderson@westmorechurch.com. Get in touch with her. VBS is just around the corner. We're going to be having a big kickoff for that very soon, as well as if you're interested in helping with VBS, get in touch with Pastor Eric, our children's pastor. He would love to talk to you. Maybe you can't do every night. Maybe you don't want to actually be in there doing things with kids, but we need all kinds of workers helping in all different areas. So we'd love to have you be involved in that. Graduation Sunday is coming up the 28th of this month. And so if you are either a high school graduate, get in touch with Pastor Rob. But if you are a college or master's or doctorate degree, we want to celebrate you too. So you can get in touch with Pastor Renee. Just call the church office and we'll make sure those things happen. You don't have to be a young person. Maybe you're 40 or 50 and just, or 70 and just finished your doctorate. We want to celebrate your success and accomplishment as well. So we'd love to have you join us for being a part of that if you have a graduate.
There are so many wonderful discipleship things yes. happening at Westmore. Life groups and focus groups. Our life groups are very much interest-based. Mm-hmm. There's also a category of groups that are under spiritual formation. So if you're into deep diving into Bible yes. studies, we have that available on Wednesday nights mm-hmm. and scattered throughout the week. But also things like e-biking, pickleball, yep. Knitting.
Summer's here. So yes, I mean, spring, here. Summer, so
that's
activities.
Right. So check that out on our website, westmorechurch.com/ministry/groups. There are several new groups that are starting in May, and we just invite you to join and connect with us through discipleship. And then on Sunday nights, our focus groups, they yeah. go all year round, and you don't want to miss that, and just no. be a part of the community and grow in the Lord.
That's right, connecting with one another. Sunday morning is so, so wonderful, but connecting on an individual, small Amen. Community level, that's what the body of Christ is about. And we are actually getting ready to go into the family room to worship this morning with the Lee Singers, our special guests this morning. They're going to be with us throughout the service. We're also going to be having baptism. Let's go into the service right now and worship the Lord.
God bless you.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow, blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavens.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Come on, let's really give him a big hand clap. He's worthy to be praised. Amen. Good to see you on this beautiful, beautiful morning, and we're blessed to have Lee University Singers, are we not? They're a wonderful, wonderful group of young people, and we're so proud of you. We want to, here in the beginning of the service, take care of something that's very, very important, and that is to baptize some people that have reaffirmed their commitment to Christ or have found Christ. It's a very, very important matter. Jesus commanded it, did he not? He commanded it because it marks us, it seals us. It says that we are not ashamed to identify with Christ. For when you are publicly baptized, all know that you have died with Christ, been buried with Christ, and have risen from the dead with Christ. How many are glad that we have done that by faith? Amen? And so baptism just simply says, I've said it before, you get to testify without ever saying a word. It's especially designed for you that are shy. You get to be baptized, and it's for all, actually. But you never have to utter a word. Just by symbolic action, you're saying, I have died, I have been buried, and I have resurrected. So understanding that, we have some people that are getting in the tank. They're already there. Pastor Becca is going to be baptizing Michelle Rogers. These are special people. They've been part of us for a while. Michelle, we love you. We're honored to do this. Based on your profession of faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah. We ought to be thankful for such things. While Michael is getting into the tank, it's wonderful to report again from Holy Week, 40-some people finding Christ, to hear about our children. I think it was close to 30 found Jesus Christ. It was wonderful to hear about what's happening with our young people. We still believe that salvation is the greatest miracle that can ever be experienced on the face of the earth. It's transformation. We may look the same on the outside, but we're not the same on the inside. Understanding that that's Michael's profession of faith. He's been transformed through death, burial, resurrection. We baptize him in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. Now we have Miss Kendra Beck. I mentioned to you the Lord is moving among our high school students, but also our middle school students. What a beautiful thing it is. And if you're family members have not been baptized, let them know how important it is to identify, why Jesus said to do it. And so based on Kendra Beck's profession of faith, we baptize her in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Yeah. Now we have Miss Isabel Moore. 12 years old, entering the tank. What a beautiful thing to not be shy about my transformation. So Isabel, based on your profession of faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. By the way, I know her parents, Jonathan and Brittany Moore, are very proud, and we're thankful for them. Pastor Eric is entering the tank. They turned the camera off, so in case he slipped, we wouldn't have a problem. But I'm kidding. I'm teasing. Pastor Eric has been so excited about what's been happening in the children's ministry, and we all are. We celebrate what God's doing there. And just know that if your children are back in the children's ministry area, they're getting fed the Word of God. And that's an exciting thing. Amen? I'm really thankful for children's ministry. Amen? I really am. Thank God for it. Yeah. First one there in the tank is Benson Moore. He looks like he's ready to go. I mean, he's ready. So based on Benson's profession of faith, we baptize him in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Once again, I know that Jonathan and Brittany are very, very proud. And now we have Riley Rogers. Her parents were baptized first, Michelle and Michael. And I know they're thankful. This is a family affair. So Based on Riley's profession of faith, we baptize him in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. 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 Praise the Lord. Let's really give the Lord praise. Come on. Let's give him big praise. He's worthy of our praise. Amen. Amen and amen.
Good morning. Can we stand as we remain in worship? Come on, let's sing together. See, Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaking. Oh, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. Oh, so why would he fail now? He won't. Still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I build my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful.
Sing rain came.
you believe for it this morning? How many of you would say this morning, I have something that seems immovable in front of me? Just raise your hand right now. It really honestly seems immovable. How many of you have something that you would say it seems unbreakable? It's not going to change. Could you just raise those hands back up to the Lord and say, I believe for it. Say it with me. I believe for it. Now don't say it if you don't believe it, because he knows. Lord, I believe for it. One more time, all together. Lord, I believe for it. Father, we come before you with hands uplifted and raised. You are able to move the unmovable. By yourself, by your power, by your anointing, by your word, by your touch, by your very breath, God, you are able to move what literally seems impossible to us this morning. You are able to break through things that seem like they can never be broken. Habits, difficulties, financial issues, relationship issues. God, you are able to break chains, and you are able to break cycles of abuse and cycles of habits. God, you are able. We believe for it this morning. God, we don't just say it with our lips, but we feel it in our hearts. We speak it in faith. Those things we do not see as though they already are. And God, I believe for it this morning. You have over and over this week in my personal life, you have shown me you are able. And so I believe for it this morning. And Lord, we believe for ourselves, but just like those who took the man to Jesus and let him down, sometimes we have to take our brothers and sisters and believe for them. And so, Lord, I believe for those who don't have faith this morning. I believe for those who are watching online this morning who feel absolutely destitute and they feel all alone. Remind them this morning they are not alone. You are there with them and you are able. And so, Lord, we bring to those this morning that have needs. We bring Doug Parker in the passing of his father, that you would comfort that family, that you would be with them in California. Lord, that you would just let them know that you are there and your presence is there to guide them through this. Lord, we pray for Matt Rapati and Lenny LaMagna, Lord, for Betty Wilson, those who are part of our body that are struggling, that may be in the hospital today that we don't even know about. Father, we ask you that you would show up there in your presence and in your power. And Lord, this morning we pray especially for Israel and the Middle East. God, we ask you to calm and to simmer what's happening over there. We ask you, Lord, that the presence of Messiah would be real in that place. Lord, that Messiah would be seen and that Messiah would be known, Father, and that you would cease the tempers and cease those who would like to lead to different altercations and those who would even like to push towards war. Lord, we don't know what's going to happen, but God, you're over all of that too, and we need not worry. So Lord, we thank you today that we can come before you and we can worship you. We praise you for this opportunity. You are so good. You are so good. And we just want to tell you that this morning. Thank you so much in Christ's name. Amen. Just one more time. I believe for it. I believe for it. You may be seated. Isn't God good? He is so good. He is so faithful to us. And we are just glad that you are in the family room this morning to worship this morning. And if you're here for the first time, can I just say we are so glad that you are here. I mean, genuinely, from our hearts, we are glad that you are here with us this morning. And if you are, we would love to get to know you. There's a connect card in front of you in the back seat. There is a QR code that in the stadium seating and in the back, that backseat pocket that you can fill out so that we can just get to know you a little bit better, that we can help you find a place to find community within this great family of Westmore. And so we would just love to invite you to do that. Also, just always a reminder, on the back of that card, there is a place for you to put prayer requests. We have multiple prayer teams throughout the week. They want to lift you up. They want to believe for it with you. so you're not believing alone. So please fill that out. You can take that card to the information center or drop it in the offering bag in just a moment. Also, if you are here today and you would like to go to our guest explorer lunch, we would love to have you. And you can just meet someone there at the information center and they'll direct you the right direction where you can join us for that lunch. One other really important announcement. Can you believe we're already at graduation season? I am just in shock over that. Some of those up here are probably super excited about that and you think it couldn't come soon enough. But we are at graduation season, and if you have a high school graduate, you need to see Pastor Rob. Get in touch with him so that we don't leave them off the list. Or if you are graduating from college, maybe from with your master's, maybe even some doctorate degrees in the house, if you are graduating, we want to honor you. So make sure that you let us know that you are graduating. Because if you don't know, how are we going to know? Just let us know. Don't forget the normal things, life groups, signing up for dinner in the commons, as well as focus groups tonight. And now we're going to give. Just give because he's good. Give because he commands. Give because we have the opportunity to be a part of the kingdom of God. And those are great reasons to give. Father, we are grateful to you. As I said before, you have touched and you've proven yourself faithful to me this week, even when I didn't expect it. And so, Lord, I give out of a heart of love, and I thank you for the opportunity to be a part of what you're doing in this world. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Come on, let's give him big praise. Wow. One of my favorite memories of my mother, and some of you will not believe this, I don't talk about it often, but she was 5 foot tall. And she was my real mother. But I remember as a child, at times, not looking people in the eye. I don't know why. My sister was the same way as a little child growing up and getting toward my teenage years. I remember her, when we would look away, it could be a waitress, a waiter, it could be somebody of importance, it could be the principal of a school, it could be a teacher. But oftentimes, without embarrassing us, she would try to pull us aside a little bit, and she'd take that finger and put it underneath my chin. And she'd say, when somebody's speaking to you, you look them in the eye. Lift your head up. She taught us not to be cocky, but to be confident. The Lord gives you an invitation to lift up your head, to get your eyes set on him, to walk into his throne room boldly. You don't have to be inhibited. You say, Pastor, you don't understand how I'm living. You don't understand my background. You don't understand what I did yesterday. It doesn't matter. There's a God that wants you to lift up your head and look him in the eye and make your request known unto him, and he will be there for you. Do you believe that today? Amen, 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 amen. Well, we sure have enjoyed Lee University Singers, haven't we? And we absolutely have. And there have been four directors, and if my memory serves me correctly, and Dr. Brad Moffat has served 18 years, and he will finish his tenure, or his task, I should say, in May, after 18 years of service. He feels the Lord has redirected him a little bit, and we're all sad about that, are we not? If not, act like you are, and let's let him know that we appreciate him. Could we do that? We love you. Honor you. 18 years, that's a while, and we appreciate him and so respect him. And the rich tradition that Lee University Singers have meant for the college, the community, the university, I should say. And I think we have 6 or 7 Westmoreites up there. Is that true? 6 or 7 Westmore? Look at here. Raise your hands. Don't be shy. Yeah. Let's let them know we're proud of them as well. We're proud of you guys. Yeah. I want you to turn in your Bibles to John 20, verses 11 through 18. And my voice is a little bit stronger. It's not all the way back, but it's a little better than it was last week for sure. So, excuse me, but we're making progress. John 20, verses 11 through 18, I'm going to unpack a little bit of what I was going to talk about last week, which was the week after Easter. Did you know what you believe matters? We sang about what we believe just a few moments ago. Lee University Singers led us in a beautiful song about we believe. What you believe really, really matters. What you believe impacts one's decisions and actions. Did you know that? What you believe affects who one marries. Or it should. What you believe can impact one's choice of college. What you believe impacts one's choices as it relates to friends you choose. What you believe should affect how you spend your time. What you believe directly determines your lifestyle choices. What you believe impacts values and priorities. What you believe determines how one faces death. What you believe affects what one does with their Sunday mornings. I didn't get one amen on that. What you believe determines how one faces grief. What do you believe? What do you really believe. 2 weeks out from Easter, do you really believe that Jesus Christ got up out of the grave and is alive today because of resurrection? Does it really matter? And if it does, how does it interface with my life? How does it impact? Just a few questions I've asked. I could have went on and on and on with many more questions. What do you believe? Did you know that one of the core beliefs that Christians have historically been willing to die for? They've been willing to die for it historically, is the doctrine of resurrection. In other words, the belief that Jesus arose from the dead, and their unwillingness to compromise that truth or to deny that truth cost them their life. Historically, it's been a huge, massive issue. It's the very thing that tends to divide religions around the world. Most religions do not deny whether or not Jesus existed. What they deny is that he resurrected from the dead. I just feel an urge. Can we give him big praise today that he got up from the dead? Yes. You say, Pastor, this is an Easter sermon. Let me tell you, every Sunday is an Easter sermon. Every day is a resurrection day. Every day needs to be a new day, a new beginning, where I'm forgetting those things which are behind, those failures, those thoughts, those whatever I did, whatever I said, I'm forgetting those things which are behind, and I'm pressing toward the mark, the prize of my high calling. Can I tell you that's only possible through resurrection power? Resurrection. The Apostle Paul dealt with the issue this way. All of the early church fathers and disciples, apostles, all of them had to deal with this. The Apostle Paul dealt with the issue this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 8. He says, there's eyewitnesses. He says, there's over 500. There's the 500 plus witnesses. And then there's the apostles, and there's those that have fallen asleep, and there's James. And he goes on through this list. And he said, these all witnessed it and claimed they saw it with their own eyes. Now, if you deny his resurrection, you got a problem dealing with those witnesses. Last time I checked, it only took one good witness or a couple good witnesses in a court of law. We're talking about a lot of witnesses. Eyewitnesses. But he also talks about evidence in verses 12 through 19. Now, if Christ be preached that he's been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? How in the world could you ever say that? But if there is no resurrection from the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty. And your faith, your transformation is all empty. It really didn't happen. It's a figment of your imagination, is what he's saying. Yes, we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised him from the dead, raised Christ from the dead. We're on the line. Our lives are on the line. We went on the line with all of this. And if he didn't resurrect, it's all for nothing. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. In other words, you're hopeless. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. Everyone that's died before you, they're done. There's no hope. In this life, only we have hope in Christ. We are all men, the most pitiable. In other words, we needed his resurrection. We need his help. We are dependent upon his resurrection. One of the core beliefs that can never be compromised is the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And as believers, resurrection invades and it intersects with every aspect of our lives. And did you know that there were 10 appearances by our Lord after his death? That's where all these witnesses came forth. There were 10 appearances after his death. It's powerful. And so all 10 of his appearances were designed to bring proof and credibility to the doctrine of resurrection, that he had indeed, not kind of, but he had indeed resurrected from the dead. Over the next few weeks, we're going to talk about how we can have confidence that our Lord got up from the grave. Resurrection, it's called. Every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday, not just Easter. Every day, I've already said it, should be Resurrection Day. Because Jesus is alive, seated at the right hand of the Father, continuously lifting you and I up when we fall. He's a good God, isn't he? John 20 gives us snapshots of these appearances. It doesn't cover all the appearances, but it gives us some snapshots. We find in chapters 20 through 21 how Jesus appears in our grief after resurrection. After resurrection, Jesus appears in our grief. He appears in our broken dreams. He appears in our fears. He appears in our doubts and lack of faith. Remember doubting Thomas? He appears right in the middle of a faith crisis. He appears. He appears in Peter's work, having to make a living out fishing. He appears when he needs provision. He appears in their careers. And I will submit and say resurrection invades every aspect of our life when you really think about it. Because of resurrection, we have hope no matter what circumstances life brings us. I find it fascinating that in John 20, verses 11 through 18, that Jesus chooses, watch this, he chooses his very first appearance to be to a grieving Mary. He could have chose any situation. He could have chose any situation to be first. But he chooses a grieving woman to make his very first appearance. What does that tell us? Listen to me. The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. You didn't get that. The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. What we're going to find out in weeks to come, the perfect remedy for anxiety is resurrection. The perfect remedy for provision is resurrection. The perfect remedy for problems in the workplace is resurrection. The perfect remedy for healing is resurrection. Everything we need is wrapped up in a resurrected life, a Jesus who is alive and well, seated at the right hand of the Father. Aren't you glad that he appears in our grief? The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. Because he lives, my loved one will live. I said they'll live if they have faith. Let's read the scripture together very quickly. When I say together, let's read along with me. Beginning with verses 11 through 18. Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. It's a sad scenery. She's weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. She saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they had said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Now some of you get offended at that. You don't relate to me? I'm just saying. They ask, "Why are you weeping? What is it we're believing here that could keep us from weeping? Are you with me? Why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Now, when she had said this, she turned around and saw, oh, wow, saw who? Jesus is standing there. She sees Jesus standing there, and Jesus said to her, "Woman," I tried that on Debbie once, it didn't work. But anyway, he said, "Woman, woman," just the thought, I'm moving right along, Deb. But anyway, "Why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, she thinks he's the gardener. I mean, she can't not possibly believe he's alive and he's standing right there. And she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him and I'll take him away. Give him to me." And Jesus said to her, I love this, "Mary." "Mary." And she turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say, "Teacher." And Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father." Stop your clinging to me. You're going over the top. Stop it. You're not seeing the big picture here. Don't smother me, because I am going to leave. And when I go, you're not going to see my body again. I'm going to go to my brethren and say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father and to my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples, I love this, Mary Magdalene, not Peter, not a great evangelist, not Benny Hinn, not Billy Graham, but Mary. Mary went and announced that she saw Jesus, and he spoke these things to her. I find it fascinating that the very first appearance of our Lord makes it not only, it's not only to prove his resurrection, but also to demonstrate how his resurrection is the antidote for all grief. We ought to be approaching funerals differently. And I don't want you to take me wrong as if to say we're never to grieve. Of course, there's a paradox in all of that. There's healing in it. We're going to talk about that a little later to get it out. But you know, sooner or later, the Holy Spirit's going to move you beyond your grief because you know that they're in a better place. Can we give the Lord praise that there's a better place? There's a better place. There really is a better place. Aren't you glad because of resurrection, he not only overcame death, but he carried our grief. It's an antidote for grief, his resurrection. He carried our grief by giving us hope that there will always be a tomorrow because of resurrection. According to Isaiah 53:4, one of the many reasons he died and resurrected was he bore our griefs, it says. He carried our sorrows. Did you get that? He carries your sorrows. He bore your sorrows. When we've been through deaths in our family, and we've been through my father and my mother and my grandchild, and it's not about me. My whole family's been through that kind of stuff. And I don't know what we would do without one to get underneath the sorrow and the grief and to lift that and say, hey, you're going to see them again. There's going to be a day when you sit down with them again. He carries it. He bores it. He puts his shoulder underneath it with you, no matter how heavy it gets, and he'll lighten the load. You may feel some of it, but it will not be overwhelming because of a resurrected Savior. Our griefs, he carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. Grief, something we don't talk about, but isn't it interesting that the very first appearance made by Jesus once again is to a broken, grieving woman. When he could have chosen the context, he could have chosen the content with whom he would meet in his first appearance, but notice who he chose. I think it's significant. Notice whom he chose and the context of his meeting. He chose in his first appearance a female, and with his choice, it was a female with whom he gave his first holy assignment after his resurrection. Listen to me, brothers, you that got a problem with women preachers, you got a problem with this passage. Now, don't leave the church over that because that's your fundamental doctrine. Dear God, get a life. The very first gospel message preached that he had died, you know what the gospel is? It's got three or four points. He died, he went to the grave, and has risen from the dead, and is now alive and well, ascended at the right hand of the Father. That's the fullness of it. But she had death, burial, resurrection, and she goes in, and she begins to proclaim it. It was a woman that preached the first gospel message in the New Testament. Some of you are afraid to death to say amen. Afraid somebody will see you on media today saying amen. He chose his first appearance. It was a female. And with his choice, it was a female with whom he gave his first holy assignment after his resurrection. This is very significant. She became the first person chosen to carry the good news of the gospel. Her message to the disciples and others was that Jesus arose, Christ arose, and that he would ascend. He told her that, I will ascend. And so she went in and began to preach it and teach it and broadcast it and talk about it. What about that? Yeah, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. This is very, very significant. She became the first person chosen to carry the good news of the gospel. The most important revelation and message ever shared was given to a female first. I love it. That message and revelation was, gentlemen, he's risen. I've seen him. Well, why didn't he appear to me? You can't get your credentials. What is he doing? I need to move on because I could get really in the weeds with this. But move. How many in this room have been touched by grief? I'm going to say this not as a prophet of doom, but if you haven't, you will. So if you're leaning on your hands and looking down and bored to death, let me just tell you something. You need to hear what I'm telling you because you will face it. It's part of life. And I find it fascinating and prevalent that Jesus made his first appearance to a woman that was carrying a deep, powerful, painful emotion. And if you're honest, sooner or later, you'll be impacted by such a thing. It's not to be a prophet of doom, it's part of life. And how you handle it will be critical to how you move forward in life. Your faith will be tested, especially you that were naming and claiming and quoting every scripture and playing music in the ear on your dying days. I'm not cutting on that. That's a fact. I've been there. I've done it. It's real. So grief is the one crisis all of mankind will have to deal with in our lifetime. It's really prevalent. The perfect remedy for grief, listen, the perfect remedy for grief is, you got it, is resurrection. The Grief Institute defines grief this way. Grief is the conflicting feelings caused by the end or change in a familiar pattern of behavior. It's not just death. Let's broaden our understanding of grief. They claim that there are many causes of grief. There's 101. I looked this up and was dealing with this, and I've done it in the past. It's unbelievable how many causes of grief there are that can cause deep emotions that manifest themselves in the context of grief. Death of a spouse, obviously, divorce, marital separation, imprisonment, death of a close family member, personal injury or illness, where your lifestyle is altered, marriage, moving right along, dismissal from work, marital reconciliation, change in health of family member, pregnancy, business readjustment, change in a financial state, death of a close friend. You know what? I'm not going to read them all. There's 101 different causes for grief depending how it impacts you. Consider the broad spectrum of grief. We've all been touched by grief. Grief can be paralyzing if it's unchecked. You say, Pastor, this is kind of boring. It really wasn't what I was looking for. This is one of those deals that if it hadn't hit you today, it's going to come along your way. It's real life. I like us to look at real life. We can talk about things that feel fluffy and make us leave, and we get to do that from time to time. And let me just tell you, as a pastor, I love that. I love it when we feel so excited about all the cool things that are going on and we get to celebrate. But I also think that we need to get down where the rubber hits the road, because I don't know what you have to face tomorrow. I don't know what I have to face tomorrow. We want to be equipped through the Word of God to be able to handle those things, do we not? Can we give him big praise for the Word? The Word, the Word, the Word, the Word. So, grief can be paralyzing. This is why I believe our Lord dealt with grief in his very first appearance, because grief is the one human battle that will impact everyone. The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. It's fascinating and interesting that after our Lord's resurrection, we immediately get some insight as to how we as believers should handle it. So what can we learn real quick, real fast, from this passage? What can we learn from this particular scripture about grief? Some quick principles that we need to apply. What can we do? First of all, let it out. Everybody say that with me. Let it out. Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. Well, I don't like to be around weepers. Just hope you don't hit a spot in the road where you find yourself weeping. Weeping. She wept so hard that she stooped down. The Bible said she looked into the tomb, hoping to see something that would let her know that his body is there, because she had nothing else to hold on to. So what we see here is a reaction. Mary's weeping, devastated, disappointed, and despondent, and she had to let it out. Let it out. Have you ever been there? Can you imagine her dreams are shattered, hopelessness and despair are all she's feeling? And one of my problems with our so-called faith movements is we feel inhibited to let it out lest somebody thinks we have a lack of faith, which is about the dumbest thing I've ever heard. We forget that we're also human. Am I okay? If I'm not, I believe I'm okay. It's okay to let it out. It's okay to cry. But it's not okay to be completely captured by your grief. Otherwise, it weakens the power of resurrection in our lives. We need to let it out, but it's not okay to be completely captured and knocked off the rail and thrown into a faith crisis because you didn't get from a sovereign God what you wanted when you wanted it. Am I making any sense? So it's okay to cry, but it's not okay to be captured. Paul said this, listen closely, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. We don't sorrow like others. I love that about Pastor Wendell Smith, who's worked here with us for years and years and still helps us out when we're in a pickle and needing somebody to help us out in an assisted living center or a nursing home. And a lot of people don't know it, but there's been seasons we've had 17 people in assisted living centers, and we try. We don't always do the best, but we try to hit with two visits a month, and that's 34 visits just with shut-ins. And then you add to it hospitals and those kinds of things, and we've had to have a little help now and then. And Wendell still helps us. Don't you appreciate Pastor Wendell? He's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful guy. Thank God for the generations. And Pastor Wendell has said this to me many times. He said, Pastor, we die differently. We die differently. He said, we don't. He said, and he even made it specific. He said, I noticed Westmore people die differently. He said, we're supposed to die differently. Listen to what Paul said. I don't want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those things who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. You don't sorrow like the world. Doesn't mean we try to hide it. We let it out. We grieve. We have our time. But we also know there's resurrection power that's going to be infused into our lives that provides the hope that we need to carry on. We don't sorrow as others who have no hope, for if we believe, listen to what he says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. What is he saying? There's going to be a day when they get up. There's going to be a day when they're released from that grave. There's going to be a day when you see him again. We are filled with hope because we don't sorrow as others because we know a better day's coming. Come on, we ought to give him big praise for that. That's huge. That's huge. We don't sorrow like others. We always have hope. It's more than just Easter. We don't just show up on Sunday morning of Easter and say, well, he lives, we're going to celebrate that. He lives every day. We have hope every day. When Mary's grief was let out, there wasn't only a reaction, there was a release. Perhaps we all let it out in different ways, but you're designed to let it out. If gone unchecked or if it's not released, internalizing grief can be unhealthy. In fact, it can manifest itself in a lot of different ways, and I didn't have time to unpack that this morning, but anger and causes relational problems and the way you deal with others around you, and you might not even recognize it as grief, but if it goes unchecked and you haven't infused that resurrection power in there, it can be a problem. If you're in the family room this morning and find yourself struggling or stooped over in your spirit like a Mary of old, covered with grief, just know that because he lives, you can face tomorrow. He can stand up, he can stand you up, he can turn you around, he can get you back on your feet. Some of you are bent over this morning. Things have changed in your life, and it was things that were unexpected, and you didn't see it coming, and it may have been in years gone by, but you haven't totally dealt with it. Things have changed in your life, but listen, believe me, he's about to stand some people back up when you get resurrection power taken over in your life. Secondly, not only let it out, but listen for heavenly help. It's there. Sometimes I'm convinced we look for earthly help without realizing heavenly help is available. Who is your first go-to? Maybe that's the way we look at this. Who is your first go-to? I don't want to be misunderstood. Going to a pastor can be good. Going to elders can be good. Going to counselors is fantastic. All of those things are good. Now, I wouldn't give you a flip for a counselor or a pastor that didn't point you to Jesus. Because you don't have the total help without resurrection power. And you're really not a good pastor unless you don't lean into him. Because that's where your ultimate help comes from. Am I making sense? So we try councils, pastors, classes, which we offer classes here. We offer U-Turn. It's been fantastic, the report. Pastor Ginger has been through grief in the deepest way herself and her own story. And please know that community is important, and the Westmore family is important, and the family room's important, and friends, and all of that's important, but there's nothing like Jesus. The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. Our Lord has provided heavenly help. And help while in the dead places. Notice the dead places here. She's hanging around a tomb. She's in the dead places. Notice how Mary's grieving in a dead place, and she's looking for his body in a tomb, and she's looking for something, anything left of Jesus, and she at least thought she could be consoled by being close to his body. And I'm not cutting on this because I've done it myself and driven up to a cemetery or driving down the highway and swing in and just to see the grave and recognize it out of respect and those kind of things. I think that's good. That's healthy to continue to process things. But can I tell you, because of resurrection, there may be a body in the grave, but they are not in the grave. They have been risen from the dead. They are not in the grave. What you have is a shell. They're not in the grave. And what does she find? The tomb is empty. Listen to me. Some of you are grieving in some dead places. You're still overwhelmed because your career took a dip 10 years ago and you haven't been able to get on your feet. And you're grieving that, and it's okay to not like it. It's okay to be bothered by it. At some point, you've got to figure out through resurrection power, how do I move forward? Some of you are grieving some dead places. Your dream is dead. The relationship is dead. I said the relationship is dead. Your finances seem dead. There's hopelessness, loneliness, and despair, and you're hanging around a tomb. And then there's something to be said for some grieving or a time of grieving, but you know what? It might be time to get back up. There's some heavenly help that's standing there that's saying, hey, it's time to move forward. I've got a holy assignment for you. I've got a new day for you. I've got something special for you. Let's complete your mission. Mary, I've got something for you. I need a big announcement. You've witnessed this. I know you're hurting over it, but I've got a big holy assignment for you. Now get in talent. Talk about it. She finds help not only in the dead places, but also while in deep grief. Angels can be standing in your dead places, and you don't even know it. I'm going to take it further. Jesus can be standing right in the middle of your situation, and you don't know it. You think he's a gardener? You're blinded? No, I'm too spiritual for that. Really? Really? I've done it. I look back. I didn't like the circumstances. I didn't like the situation. It felt like I was off the rail. But I look back, and now I recognize Jesus was standing right in the middle of that thing and providing some different direction. Providing some help and hope. Providing a plan that I thought I had down, but you know what? It wasn't about my plan, it was about his plan. Jesus can be standing in the middle of your situation. Angels can be talking to you at the gas pump and sharing something with you that you need to hear, and you get in the car and you either write them off as a quack or you write them off as somebody that really had something good to say. I wonder if they're, yeah, and you drive on and you forget about it. or you turn on the television, or you hear a song sang this morning, or you hear a little bit of what I'm saying, and the Lord is preparing you not only for what you've been through, but he's preparing you for tomorrow. So, listen for heavenly help. Thirdly, learn to let go of the temporary. Some of you are so hung up on the temporary. I can't lose my house. I can't lose this. I can't lose that. You're battling to hold on to what you got. Hold on to life. Can I tell you that that child that you've dedicated is not yours? You may call them my son or my daughter, but they're not yours. He's the giver of life. He's called you to manage that life, but they're not really yours. That wife you call yours, my wife, some of you don't like this, but ultimately it's not yours. She's not yours. She's his. My dad, my brother, my cousin, my best friend. We love the my word, but ultimately he's the giver and taker of life. You say, oh, no, the devil came and took. Oh, no, the devil can't touch anybody, but what, he don't give him permission to do so? The Bible says he comes to steal. It doesn't say he can steal. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He's got to get permission from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to ever touch a believer's life. We ought to give the Lord big praise for that. That's a big deal. That's really a big deal. I know that's hard for some of us. It's hard for me. I want to look at those little grands and say, that's my grand, or my son, my daughter-in-law, my this, my that. And it's good for the sake of family, but when taken too far, none of it's ours. Everything around us is temporary. There's only one God, and he's eternal, and he's building eternal things, and we can put our hope in those eternal things that are to come. Learn to let go. Folks, you're passing through here. What are we thinking? We're going over our portfolio this week and just kind of looking at things, and we do that from time to time, and a thought hit me on what I was talking about this week, and I thought, it's all temporary. It's all temporary. Let go of the temporary. You know, and what must we do to make all of this work? Remember our teaching. Everything is temporary. I listened to an actor, and I'm terrible with actors. I can remember sports guys and all of that, but I don't do real well with TV people. My family members and cousins help me with who that actor is and that is, and I'm just terrible remembering their names. But anyway, I was listening on the news one night. An actor had been diagnosed with, he was terminally ill. And they asked him, what is that like? He was out talking about his diagnosis and that he didn't have a long time to live. And so I'm sitting listening to this kind of casually, and suddenly I heard him respond to the reporter, to the person interviewed, the interviewer, I should say, and he said, look, what do you mean, how do I feel? We're all terminal. I hadn't thought of that way. He looked at the reporter, the interviewer, and he said, you're terminal. The only difference is the doctors kind of told me that I have this little season to live, but you're terminal too. I was shocked. I thought, what a truth. Now that might not sound so good to you, but hello, it's appointed unto man once to. I'm trying to give you hope. This isn't negative. Resurrection power remedies all this. This isn't where we put all of our hope here. We're in trouble if all of our hope is here. We're in trouble if this is our hope. Listen to the news for Pete's sake. We're in trouble if we're putting all of our hope in this temporary stuff. Your government's temporary. I hate to pop some of your balloons. The president is temporary. Some of you like that. A few of you won't. And the next one's going to be temporary if Jesus tarries. The parties are temporary. Everything's temporary. And I'm really going to pop somebody's balloon here, so the Lord help me right now. The United States of America could be temporary. But there's one that is not temporary. There is a King of Kings and a Lord of Lords who is not temporary. He's got this thing in his control. He's not temporary. All of our hope is not on the election. All of our hope is not on who gets it. None of this is that important. Yes, let's do business and it's okay to talk about, but that's not where our ultimate hope lies. It's temporary stuff. Remember our teaching. And so we release the temporary. Here's the words, let it go. Oh, the bank may do this or this may happen. It's okay to prepare for that, to protect for your future, your kids' future. There's nothing wrong with that, but taken too far, it will wreck you and emotionally wreck you if you put too much confidence in the temporary. He's made us promises. Release the temporary. Your value and hope is not found in the temporary. Your state of existence, your possessions, your gifts and talents, your career, your influence, your relationships, your family, your situation, everything you love or everything you hate on this earth is temporary. The perfect remedy for grief is resurrection. Finally, let's wrap this up. Look at the big picture. The big picture is that she is the first person to communicate the gospel message. That's big picture stuff. And you know what her message was? The greatest message, the foundation of the entire Christian faith. He has risen. The greatest message ever preached. He has risen. A woman who had the first message of our Lord's resurrection. Look at her. Look at her. Not only her role, but look at his resurrection. I think there are times we allow our grief to cloud our vision of Christ, and we can't see the true identity of the resurrected Lord because of our grief, and therefore we only see him as a crucified Savior. And we grieve, and we identify with Good Friday, and we should, and there's something there in the story that we've got to get our arms around, but don't forget, he got up out of the grave. So while we sorrow, while we feel loss, and while we feel passion in our human side, just know that the Spirit of God dwells in you and I only because there was a resurrected Lord and Savior who infused his Spirit into you when you died with him by faith and went to the grave with him by faith and resurrected from the dead with him by faith. You have been transformed on the inside. What you need is renewed thinking. We don't sorrow as others do. We don't sorrow as other human beings. We are different because we know there's always a tomorrow. There's always a tomorrow. And eternal life awaits us. Allow me to explain, get so focused on the loss, whatever it might be, that we can't see what God is doing in the big picture. I've watched empty nesters. Debbie and I did a little bit. Grieve when the kids left the house. I remember one day we sat down at the table and it felt so awkward. Especially when Kyle left because all the talking stopped in the house. That's a compliment, yeah. He kept the house alive. And then John, we had our third son, and then John left, and Dad was there, and Dad had his own life. He's at the caring place 8-10 hours a day, and he'd come home for dinner, and there Debbie and I sitting there staring at each other. Not knowing what to talk about. We should. It's our fault. We had to kind of work at that. Because all of our conversations centered around our kids. Where they got to be? What are they going to do? Chris and Jennifer, I see some witness there. If it hadn't fully come, it's coming. But what we failed to see, it's a new season for our children. It's a big picture. It's a transition. And so now to see them succeed and see God do amazing things through their lives, they had to transition out of that. Does that make sense? But when we get hung up on the grief and how lonely we are and our marriage is not this quite the same and we've got to pivot on this thing because we don't know what to say to each other. And the kids are even deciding where we're always eating. We didn't even know how to make a decision where we want to eat. But the beauty in it, it's a new season. It's a new season. God gets to do something great to those kids that we believe he has holy assignments for, and we've done our part for this season. It's time to release them and let them go. Some of you parents need to let your kids go, by the way. Just a thought. Death of a loved one. We don't see the big picture. Isaiah 57, verses 2 and 3 tackles this. We don't see the big picture. It says good people die. Did you know good people die? Good people are going to die. Good people do die. That's what he means when he says the righteous perish. That's what he's literally saying. Good people die. And nobody takes it to heart. Merciful, good people, he says, are taken away. While no one considers that the good people that are taken away from evil, they're taken away from evil. And they shall enter into a peace, and they shall enter into rest in their beds. And each one will begin walking upright, and they won't have to worry about sin anymore. It's a big picture. It's a good thing. Paul said it this way, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. How could he say such a thing? Because of resurrection power. Resurrection power. Listen to this quote from Rick Warren. One can't have life without transition. Transition without change. Change without loss. It's how you handle the loss that's so important. So, listen to Isaiah 53:4 again. He has borne our griefs and he's carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He has borne it all. But the perfect remedy after he was beaten, after he was crucified, after he was thrown in the grave, the perfect remedy to all of their grief was that he has risen. And the perfect remedy to your grief this morning, any big change that you went through, fill the blank with your name in it and listen closely. Ginger, April, Henry. I could walk all over this congregation right now of stories of loss in the last couple of years. Listen to your name. He has risen. And those losses that you've experienced as resurrection power is applied, just know they've risen too. They've risen too. You know what? I have this crazy feeling. Some of you are going to think I'm nuts. I have a feeling you have no idea who's watching us this morning. We worry about media. We worry about all of those things. Some of your dads are looking down here like mine is. We've got such a great cloud of witnesses, the Bible says, in Hebrews, that are observing us and watching us. I don't even know where that cloud is, whether it's here. I've often said, I think in crazy ways. Is it here and I just can't see it? Or is it way up there? Where is the cloud? I don't know where it is, but the Bible says there's a cloud of witnesses that are looking over us. People of faith. People of faith. And you know what? One day we might just transition if Jesus tarries, and not might, we will. If Jesus tarries, we will transition and we'll be part of that great cloud of witnesses. The beautiful thing in all of this isn't a message of gloom and doom. It's a message of great hope. It's a message of great hope. The biggest remedy that you could ever apply to grief is resurrection. It's the anecdote. Grab it. Believe it. Believe in it. And then look for your holy assignment, because God may have something for you to say to somebody, something to do, something to move forward as you transition into another season. God is good, isn't he? Could you stand with me? Now, I want to give the ultimate one who got up from the grave and made a decision to go through all of that, and he's watching today. Can we let Jesus Christ know that we're pretty happy that he resurrected for you and I? He got up. He got up. He really got up. He's watching. We've got a few elders that'll be here. If you are experiencing grief, and we're going to ask you to, elders, to stand off to the side, and if you just want prayer, or a little word or a little counsel, come and see them. But let me just say this. I got word Friday that one of my dear friends, Pastor Edward Robison, an African-American pastor, pastors, I believe our largest African-American church in the county or in the area, if not the largest one of them, long-term friend and just a strong man of faith, his parsonage burned, lost everything. And he, for whatever reason, didn't connect the dots that with a parsonage you have to have renter's insurance and all of that, and he's lost everything. We've joined with Westwood and North Cleveland and First Baptist and some of us pastors. We were all together in the common space this week and had a tremendous meeting as we looked toward National Day of Prayer and doing some things together. And we got on the horn together yesterday. The horn is the phone, by the way. And let's take an offering. I'm going to try to do a few things from Operation Compassion as well. Let's just do what we can do to try to help this family, these beautiful people. And sometimes the body of Christ is called on to help. Maybe that's our holy assignment today. And that same resurrection power that's in his heart perhaps will move you and I to be a part of the solution as we share and are part of the same body of Christ. So at the doors, I ask our ushers to stand. Anything you can do, I ask our ushers to be out there ready to receive. Anything you can do, anything that would move on your heart, it would be a beautiful thing. And I'll leave it at that. So Lord, when I look at the 101 different ways that people can grieve, I know in this family room this morning there are people grieving, and some of them probably aren't even aware of it. They have emotional struggles and unresolved issues because they haven't faced it. It feels too painful. And I pray for a release in the name of Jesus. I pray that your overcoming power that you make available through resurrection, just as you did Mary in your first appearance, you dealt with grief right out of the gate when you got up from the grave. I pray that we would see your remedy better than any medicine, better than anything a man can offer, but may your resurrection power be infused into our hearts, into our lives, and fill us up with your spirit, that we would walk out of here more than overcomers, on top because of your resurrection power. We ask it in Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. God bless you. Have a great day.